Yes. So today we have a small group of three Ahmadis, Mr. Rizwan Merchant from UK, Mr. Rahmat from Indonesia, and Kleem Edward from UK. They have got a lot of questions they would like to ask. Please.
So in the Bible, Genesis gives an account of Noah and the flood. Was the flood a regional one targeting a small area, or was it universal?
A universal flood of that description is impossible, because all the water in the seas and all the frozen water on the poles, if melted, put together, could not create such a flood as described in the Bible, because one fourth of the total area of Earth's surface has to be flooded with water, which sinks every mountain top, Mount Everest being no exception, except perhaps if you consider that to be the Mount Judea, right? Ararat, is it?
Yes.
Ararat. Once I asked Dr. Professor Abdul Salam, late Dr. Professor Abdul Salam, to calculate how much water would be needed to create such a flood as described in the Bible. He was, of course, a very well-known mathematician, universally acknowledged as such. And very shortly I got the answer, twice as much water as we have already on Earth. So why should we attribute stupidities to God? It does him no service whatsoever. The Quranic vision of that flood, not the vision, but the Quranic statement, recorded statement of that flood, is very realistic. It does nowhere claim that it was universal or a global phenomenon. It just spoke of the people of Noah and a flood which inundated the area, the valley or whatever it was, where they dwelled.
Right.
Thank
you. Please. We know that we are not allowed to offer any prayer behind non-Muslim, non-Ahmadi, I mean. But when we do so, non-Ahmadi blame us that we are creating separation.
That what?
Creating separation.
Creating separation.
Separation.
Divisions.
Division.
Yes.
Who has created this separation?
So, they blame us.
No, but you should know.
Yes.
Before Ahmadiyyat came into being, what did they do?
I see.
What is their official edict about their people belong to their sect, saying their prayers behind other imams? So for the time being, forget about Ahmadiyyat and return to the history of Islam spread over 1300 years from the time of Ahmadiyyat backwards, right? And you will find such edicts and such intolerance in matters of mutual relationship between sect and sect as an Ahmadi could not even dream in his most violent nightmares. Their edict, as against the Ahmadi edict, is that if anyone, for instance, we talk of the Barelvis, the one sect which is largest in number in the subcontinent India and Pakistan, they have written that if anyone from among us prays behind any other imam, he would immediately be out of the pale of Islam. And his kufr, that is his denial of Islam, would be worse than Christians, Jews, etc., etc. And his marriage will be broken immediately. And if he continues to live with the same wife, the children they will bear would be, you know, what they call the bad name for that. Huh? You see?
Yes.
and they will not inherit him when he dies. And such a person as this, if he marries anyone, anywhere in the world, still that marriage will be invalid, because he has forfeited all rights by the act of having become a non-Muslim through following another Imam in his prayer. And all the rubbish which follows, I can't repeat, but read the edicts of all the various sects on the issue of saying namaz behind somebody else. And you'll be amazed to see the narrow-mindedness, the stupidity and everything involved in it. If it is stupidity, if it is narrow-mindedness, why do Ahmadis follow it, however mildly they may? This is the question which I have, which we must answer. They have no right to do that, because they believe that the Imam appointed by God, who was to be appointed by God, has not yet come. And they believe that the only Imam to the Islam is the Imam Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So as long as all of them believe, at least in claim, in the truth of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they have no right to create any split, any division, on the basis of religious rites, of worship, mikah, death, etc., you know, funeral services, everything. They have to be performed under one Imam, that is Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, with a complete unity of purpose and action. This is but logical. And despite that, they split the entire world of Islam into these small, mean-looking sects which would not tolerate anything of cooperation with other sects in Islam. They are banned without a right. There is no justification whatsoever. Our case is a completely different case. And they agree, all of them agree to what I am going to say. We believe in a person whom we know, we have full faith, was appointed directly by God as the Imam of the latter days. We believe in Hazrat Mirza Sahib to be that Imam which who was predicted by Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam himself. We believe in him to be that Imam about whom Ahadrus Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam prophesied that when you hear of him, even if you have reached him, even if you have to reach him on your knees across glaciers, do that and get initiated at his hands. Those who reject him, do they still retain the right of imamat for themselves? It's a question as simple as that. And for Ahmadis, you know, who are about, you know, a bit cowardly in this, they feel extremely embarrassed. How shall we face them? We say, if they have, is there Imam and we don't say our prayer, what would they will say about us? The question is, what would God say about you? If they have the audacity to reject the Imam appointed by God, and they do not care a hoot for what happens, you have the timidity of not being able to reject the Imam appointed by people. This is the only comparison which you can make sensibly. You understand?
Yes.
Thank God you do. Now, I have written a book, small booklet, in fact, long ago I wrote it when I was in Waqf-e Jadid, which was entitled Why do not Ahmadis say their prayers against the non-Ahmadis? A small that has to be translated. Tell
yes.
Who is responsible for Munish?
Yes.
We have it translated into Indonesian, into English, every language. In English, I know it is translated, but it has to be widely distributed, because nowadays we are gaining converts to the tune of hundreds of thousands. About 1.5 million converted to Ahmadiyya last year, and this time, I hope it will be more beyond, inshallah. So they are innocent people, they don't know what and why. And if somebody tells them, no, they'll be surprised, they'll be shocked. They may start rethinking what we have joined, you know. So they have to be told their official view on this first. We have quoted, I attempted to quote from all the various sects their official edicts on this issue. So first they should be told, this is where you stand. You stood before becoming an Ahmadi. And this is where you stand today. The difference which is marked is the difference of mildness of the edict and the dignity of the edict. According to Ahmadiyya edict, Ahmadis, in the light of what I have told you, should not pray behind an Imam who rejects the Imam appointed by God. No sect is mentioned, no divinal titles are mentioned. All that is mentioned is whoever rejects the Imam. It is not non-Ahmadi, that is not the issue involved. Even if there is a non-Ahmadi who openly and publicly says that I believe that he was appointed an Imam by God, but I have no courage to follow him, still you can say your prayer behind him. So it's not a parochial issue of belonging to your sect or not belonging to your sect. It's a matter of principle. If somebody says in private, yes, I believe Hazrat Islam would not have such nonsense. If he is afraid of the people more than God, then such a man forfeits his right to be Imam. He must have this courage of publicly announcing that, look here, I believe that Hazrat Mirza Sahib was not false, was not untrue. Whatever he said, I don't go into the detail, but I believe whatever he said when he attributed wahi, ilham, revelation to God, he was right. And that is all. Such a person is not debarred from leading a prayer which Ahmadis can join. Right? But now what is to be highlighted is the nature of their edicts and their contents. We say he can't, and if he does, he will still remain a Muslim. He may still call himself an Ahmadi, but he will break his ties with the Ahmadiyya institution of Khilafat. He will no longer be counted within the Ahmadiyya institution of Khilafat. What a fair judgment it is. You see, no punishment is advised, no question of whatever nature. But read the edicts of the others, and then you will be amazed to see things, unimaginable things. They lose their right to inherit their fathers. Their children lose their right to inherit them. And what is further said, and you will be amazed to hear what I am going to tell you, an edict by no less a person than the greatest Imam of modern times of the Brilvi sect, which is the largest number in the subcontinent, Ahmad Raza. He says that if such a person as this even marries a beast, a bitch or anything, and bears children out of that, still that marriage will be null and void, and the children which are born to him by that beastly mother would not have a right to inherit him. This is the, you know, utter darkness of ignorance from which Hazrat Masih Maud Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has drawn you back into the light of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam.
A little question on the back of that. I mean, this is not one of the questions that I have.
Yes, yes.
But it's just that when I went to Pakistan, you heard all the azans, and it was, you know, you're compelled to think congregational prayer, the azans are being said, but it's a bit difficult. You've got to say to yourself, who's the azan? The azan is for the imam of non-Ahmadi sect.
No, for you it's not at all difficult. The problem is for them.
Yeah.
You see, you don't realize that the problem is not for us, because we know the Ahmadi mosques very clearly, and the way you bear yourself, you are recognized as an Ahmadi.
Hmm.
Even if you go to Pakistan as you are attired today here in England, they will recognize.
Hmm.
There is some nobility, some dignity, some honesty imprinted on the expressions of Ahmadis, which making them recognizable everywhere. People who return from Pakistan, the girls, etc., who visited from here to attend the marriage of my daughter, one of them told me that I was amazed to see wherever I went, the shopkeeper, etc., after a while said, "Are you an Ahmadi?" See, there was something which made her, you know, known and recognized. So, if you go to visit their mosque, you incur the danger of being beaten up and maybe into a pulp, or made to wash the floor where you tread. This is their attitude.
Hmm.
And the style of the azan, and they say, start singing things before and after and make such noises. Well, can't I recognize that easily?
No, quite.
Mm.
Of course.
Yeah.
Mm.
The problem is not for us, we know. The problem is for them, because each sect has declared that none of the adherents of that sect has a right to follow the imam of another sect. So with mosques scattered all over the country, nondescript in the style of azan, except for the Shias.
Hmm.
How can they decide whether this namaz, this imam is that or that or that or of that belonging? No, nobody can say that. And this, there is no problem.
Right, on to my real question, if I may.
Yes, okay.
So I did have a couple of people who were meant to come, but for one reason or another, they're not here. But these are their questions.
Of course.
So, this is from a lawyer who's very sort of it's all about politics anyway. In the German European countries, some political parties are Christian Democrats.
German European countries?
Well, in Germany and in Europe, their parties are called Christian Democrats.
Right.
Do you think Islamic politicians could help in the development of a united Europe?
Islamic politicians cannot help in developing a united Islam.
Yeah.
Please, next question.
Okay, what are the views of Islam on a united European currency and the problems of nationalistic pride which aims to stop a single currency?
The only view of Islam is be sensible. And whatever may you take for the goodness of mankind as such and the goodness of the people. So these matters of detail have to be settled in the light of just two things. You have to be honest and just in your decision making. Number two, you should not be prone to grab things from others. You should develop that habit, special human habit, of sacrificing your rights for the sake of others. So you should be looking outward for the rights of others more than for your own right, in this sense that if you seem to overdo in your demands, be careful that, like you, they have also their rights. If you can't sacrifice your rights, Islam would not force you. But Islam prohibits you to usurp the rights of others under any plea and under any cause. So in this spirit of mutual cooperation, whatever is decided on matters of United Nations will be good and fruitful. The rest will not bear good fruits. Right?
Yeah. I mean, the question is really, obviously it's all been written all about, it's all in the newspapers at the moment. Should England go as part of Europe? What is the future?
You see, this is a question which has not to be answered from the point of view of Islam in detail. Because all that could be answered from the Islamic viewpoint, I have already answered.
Quite.
They are Islamic attitudes. Now apply those attitudes to your decision making and you'll find yourself better off than otherwise. That is one advice which I could render. And the other one is to first of all find whatever the British people want to achieve within themselves. This is a point of parting of the ways from the old traditional entities of European nations. New identities are to be gained. This is the important question. Now the British identity before this point in time has been completely different from that of other European countries. They shared a common continent, while England has always been outside, close but not that close to them. Again, England has been always looking across to her colonies. Even America as ex-colony and Canada as ex-colony, for their world image. This is Britain, though small, yet big enough to be extended to Americas on the one hand and to Hong Kong on the other and so on and so forth, China, etc. So you have always been trying your best to keep some of this global image intact. And successfully so, I believe, to a great degree until the time when Mrs. Thatcher completely subjected you to the, or practically subjected you to the supremacy of Americans, which was not liked by every British, which was not, you know, the ideal of every British. So I could see, you know, these this underlying discontent and displeasure at what was happening. But I believed from that perhaps Mrs. Thatcher personally was convinced that our future lies not in Europe, but in our traditional relationship with America and other colonial powers. Yet she could not decide to be completely broken from Europe. So the policies which the Conservative government has been following ever since have changed only a little bit, but basically they remain the same. They want to preserve their image of superiority over Europe by claiming the, you know, first right of friendship, preferential right of friendship with Americas and things. And the Europeans are aware of all this. They want to rub it in on you. Look here, no more of old identities. You want to join us? Join us by taking a bath, baptisma, and then join us shedding all the previous complexions and join us as a member of the European community, as one member. This is a very bitter cup for the British to take, to swallow. This is exactly what is creating all the problems. First resolve what you have to gain and what you have to lose, and decide it on this issue. I have seen some debates on television and this and that in the newspapers, but really I pity those who forget the basic issue and involve in the secondary questions. all they are wasting their time is the secondary issue or issues which evolve from the basic question which I have just discussed threadbare before you. The whole nation should be told, look here, this is the loss and gain statement. You have to forget and bury your past image after you join the community full whole hog. And these will be your gains and that will be the big loss. And if you want to retain the old British image of global supremacy and excellence, then forget about the material gains. Try somehow to survive with Europe as a friendly partner, not partner but as a friend. But already you have taken half measures forward. This is the problem. How to retrieve your steps? So these issues should be discussed exactly as I am discussing here. Right?
Thank you.
Please.
It is said that women are equal in the sight of God, yes, and that they have different, but they do have a different role to play. Are there any limitations in social, political, religious, and spiritual lives?
This issue should be taken in a broader concept than just the human concept. Every creation of God is equal to Him, to every other creation, as far as the rights of the Creator is upon the Creator. He has created everything with a specific design and characters and qualities and trends, instincts, etc., etc. He must fully respond to these requirements. If he fails to do it, he is not a perfect creator. So within the scope of each species, God has to be absolutely just. And he can't say, this is the smaller species, that is the higher species, and the requirements of the higher species should be met with, not the requirements of the lower species. So that is the meaning of equality. An amoeba can be perfectly happy within the environments of the filth where he lives and spends all, or it lives and spends all his life. Imagine the happy amoeba being drawn from filth and put into the English egg pudding. You know, that he would find it so alien to its taste, so horrible it would be like removed from heaven to hell. So this is God. This is the meaning of equality. If without keeping in mind this ultimate concept of equality, you enter into the discussions of comparative rights, what you see in case of amoeba is that it's not fair for the amoeba to be required to spend all its life in filth, without eyes, without ears, without anything. Let's remove this injustice, and a movement of lip for amoebas should start.
Free the amoeba.
Yes. And transfer his habitat from filth to the excellent chocolates and things which you can create, you can cook. Now, this is why I said this is the basic issue. If there is a difference of constitution, that difference can be within the species or outside the species. If it is within the species, still it is a difference. And God cannot shut his eyes to that difference. If he does, this will be inequality, not otherwise. So I think I have answered your question in principle, haven't I?
Yes.
My second question is, I have to travel quite a lot during My question is that
you enjoy traveling quite a lot.
Of course.
And as far as possible, you take your family with you.
Yes, sometimes.
Very good. You are lucky man. You are lucky man, huh?
Thank you.
Yes.
So my question is that during the flight, how can we determine the timing of the prayer?
Determine the timing of the prayer.
Yes, sometimes difficult.
As best as you can, with available electronic devices, etc., etc. Determine them as best as you can, and that is all which is required of you. No more.
No more.
So don't bother further whether your prayer is accepted. When you pray, within the limitation of your knowledge of directions, your love of God is not adversely influenced by that. Your memory of God is not adversely influenced by that. Remember that where the Holy Quran requires you to say the prayer in the direction of Khana Kaaba, immediately it also tells you فَأَنَمَا تَوَلُّ فَثَمَّ وَجْهُ اللَّهِ. In whichever direction you look, there will be the glory of God.
Mm-hmm.
So it is not limited to Khana Kaaba at all. And in journeys, Ahadrus sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has clearly demonstrated that if you are riding a mount, say your prayer while you are riding and in the direction in which the mount is moving. If you are moving away from Khala, you don't have to turn back, you know. So with this most wonderful, religion which keeps in view all the human various requirements and situations, what difficulty can you face? None. Try your best and that's all which is required of you, right?
Thank you.
Next question is, if Islam means peace, then why should the West fear growing Islam? In the West we have Islamophobia, which is a new term being coined.
Yes.
Do we have Hinduphobia, Buddhism phobia?
No, none.
Why should the West be frightened of Islam, is the question.
Because they themselves have created this phobia.
Monster.
So they are nurturing it. The forces which have created it, they are responsible for nurturing this and keeping it up. Because of many factors. I don't want to go into all the factors because it will cover more than an hour for me at least. But one thing I must say in answer to this question is that one of the reasons why they do it, for that the Muslim people are themselves to be blamed. And the religious clergy and political governments of different countries. They want to utilize Islam or the love of Islam for the purpose of gaining their political ends. So they whip up the sentiment against the West in the name of Islam. But it's impossible. You never read anywhere in the Quran or in the tradition of the Holy Prophet that the sentiment should be whipped up in the name of Islam against Persia, against Roman Empire, against China, against this and that. You never come across even the slightest hint of such deviance. Religion versus religion, all right.
Hmm.
But religion in politics divided against people and countries is unthinkable. So because the Muslims have committed this folly to gain their ulterior motives in the name of Islam and to deceive their own public. So the image which is put across, which is sent across Europe and the free countries, is that there, from therein lies the danger. You never hear such stupid calls for rallying round the flag of Islam by raising swords against, or the weapons, whatever they are, against colonialism and this and that, from Hindus, from Buddhists, from other religious denominations. Tell me, where have you ever heard of such a call? Never.
Mm.
It is, the prerogative of the Muslim clergy to behave so stupidly, as none of the religious clergy of today behaves like. So, partly they themselves are to be blamed, of course.
Mm.
And partly those who exploit their stupidity unnecessarily to something which they consider their advantage, but is not their advantage at all. Instead of discussing this threat barely and telling them, look, don't behave properly, and if you want to fight us, come on and let us have a fight. And you get all your weapons from us, all your financial aids and from us, development from the us. How can they think of fighting us? They should tell their own people that there is no real danger at all. That is just a stupid outcry of suppressed desires and things, of things which they cannot achieve. So, it's no more than that. Don't be afraid, there's no real danger. Instead of doing that and telling them to speak to them and make them understand the situation, let's settle our disputes among us sensibly, like civilized human beings, and stop this rubbish of dividing us into two different political camps and so on. This should have been the right attitude. It would guarantee peace to the world, and it would also be the what your political leadership owes to their people. Because they must keep them well informed of the real situation. Now, once they commit the folly of agitating their emotions with the help of the stupidity of these factors, these people I have just mentioned, they do work up a sense of hatred and a reaction of extreme resentment against such people within their own respective countries. The result is that the Muslims of all sorts and descriptions also live in all Western countries. Racism is what is fanned, and racism is ugly in every form, anywhere. It does not stop at the target for which you are creating or helping it. Once racism is set free, this cannot be shut in again. And it would, having swallowed one object, it would turn to others. So this is not fair, it's not honest, it's not mature of Western politicians to play with this fire. So, they must get down to a calm level of thinking and analyzing the global issues and trying their best to bring man together instead of utilizing or exploiting the stupidities of others to work against the global peace. This is exactly what it would be ultimately. Right?
Thank you.
Please. The promised Messiah, peace and blessings be upon him, said that all the prophets have been abused, that is the inheritance of the prophets, so how can I be deprived of it?
Yes.
Why does God allow this to happen to his prophets?
This is very important. Not only abused, beaten up and put to all sorts of torture and persecution and, you know, most cruel treatment. It has had to be like this, otherwise the sending of the prophets would become purposeless. Because the prophets do not show the miracle of refouling people just by breathing into them. This is what the people fail to understand, and that is why most prophets are rejected. They have imagined, unfortunately, that all the previous prophets were not human. Even if they were human, they had some superhuman qualities. So what they are waiting for is a magician instead of a prophet, who would reform them there without their participation, without their sacrifice. And if such a prophet is recognized by some supernatural signs, as people of today expect, like Jesus coming in glory this time, not rising from humility and humble background, then what would reform the people? Tell me. Can anything? Now back to the question, why has God chosen this course? Because this is the only inevitable course. If a magician prophet comes, every Tom, Dick and Harry, every rascal and wicked person would run forward to reach him first. Because therein he gains his glory by associating with that big man. But if he is considered to be the lowliest of the people after he has declared to be God, a man of God, the reaction is exactly the opposite. If people know that by accepting him, they have to go through the fire and toil and sweat, it's very difficult for people to face those challenges. You know that they will be disowned by our own families, by our own people. We'll be disinherited. Our properties will be robbed and looted. Only the true can make the decision, and true and brave, of joining such a people, such a prophet. And this is where his reform is already underwritten. Only true would go through the sacrifice of joining prophets who are suffering themselves for a noble cause, and unless their belief in God and their truth was unshakable, they would not join. And to see themselves rejected entirely by the powerful people of the world, grow from strength to strength, despite all this, is the ultimately proof of their being on the right path and God being at their back. Change this formula to anyone and it will fail to work. Right? Yes.
My next question is regarding istikhara.
Istikhara?
Yes. After doing
istikhara. It is very popular in Indonesia.
Yes.
Yes, I know.
So after doing istikhara, when I see some dream, sometimes it is very difficult for me to understand what is the message. So,
yes, I'm coming to that.
So, what should I do?
You should not do istikhara. Without a purpose, without a meaning. You know, istikhara has been completely misunderstood and misemployed by many people today, and mostly by Ahmadis. Because the rest do not care in istikhara at all anyway. We Ahmadis are so dedicated to God, and we know in his day-to-day guidance and care of human affairs that we seek his blessing of guidance in the matters which are important to us. This is the purpose of istikhara. But the way it is carried out is not the way it was carried out at the time of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it will not be fruitful. The purpose may be good, but the method also has to be right. Mm-hmm. Now I don't read anywhere in traditions of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that whenever you are contemplating the issue of marrying your daughter with someone, start istikhara and wait until you are shown something from God. Mentioned nowhere. What he advises you is to be honestly, to attempt honestly to find out if the person with whom you are proposing to marry your daughter is truly religious and noble and believes in God and acts righteously. If morally he is honorable and, you know, distinct from the rest, always go for that preference. Consider all other things as comparatively meaningless and trivial. His family belonging, his wealth, his physical charms, etc., should all be relegated to a secondary stage. Now, if you have to decide between two different, who else, or your daughter, then if they are equal in this, then go for kufu. That is the second advice. Kufu means that this general background of the person and the way of life and the style of life should be as close to your family as possible. If they are similar, then you can cope better. Otherwise, despite the piety, these pinpricks will continue to hurt both sides, because one has a different style, different objectives, different preferences, and the other has different, within the scope of religion, of course. Then it will become very difficult to cope. I've seen some women seek divorce, and that divorce was granted to them on the plea that my husband has some eating habits, which is so obnoxious to my taste. Daily I have to suffer at breakfast, at lunch, at dinner, and he is incurable because it is inbred in him. And the divorce was granted. So these small things fall under the category of kufr, the natural dispensation and likings and dislikings and hopes and aspirations, etc. They should be as much alike as possible. Now, the istikhara, which is done in Ahmadiyyat from the time of Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, is done after this, not before this. Once you are happy that these things are all right, then what you pray for is not for a definite dream. Then what you pray for is, God, as far as I could judge, I have done my best and I think this is the right choice. I don't know the rest. Please help me. If this proposal is bad ultimately, then somehow stop it. Or show me clearly that this is not good for you. In that case, whatever the dream, whenever a dream is shown, it is all very clear. Or something happens which breaks the proposed marriage, you know, beyond your own sphere of influence. Things happen outside your sphere of influence and the marriage is broken. The proposed marriage is broken. This is the true way of marrying, and perhaps it is in this context that you have been doing istikharas. Is that right?
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you.
Recently in the newspapers we've seen cloning coming through, yes. Clone the sheep. Can there be any good to be gained from scientist games such as this?
None whatsoever. The only thing which can unfortunately happen is the disaster for which they must wait. You see, the purpose of preservation of species is achieved by the creation of two sexes and conjugation, and all the human pleasure hinges around this pivotal design of God. Family is created through this. Closer ties between father and children, mother and children, husband and wife, etc., make one entity of a home, which is manageable, which is in fact a haven from the worldly problem, etc., within a society, a small haven of course, but to that haven those who belong to such good homes always return with full trust, even if they have met calamities. It is the family unit which takes care of them. It all moves around the spiritual concept of man and wife reproducing. Mm. What will be the structure of the society after cloning?
Yes.
Already you have fallen apart enough. Already homes are broken. And the pleasure you receive out of this, where will that pleasure be received? How? Mm. So the two different types of disasters simultaneously befalling man. the disaster of the dissolution of institutional marriage and the disaster of meeting other sex only for the sake of pleasure, with no other purpose.
Right.
And this will destroy your home, royalties, everything. The whole society will be shattered into pieces. This is what they go for. And this is what God warned against in the Holy Quran when it said that the Satan would incite my servants to change the creation of God, my creation. And when they do it, they'll be punished. Can't escape from the consequential punishment. So whether it's a change is brought about by genetic engineer in producing new forms of life or by changing the creation or method of creation, it will end up into disaster without fail. So in the book which I have been mentioning before, I have already completed, I think the last chapter is now being revised, a little bit of it is left, otherwise all the work is ready. There I also, without knowing of the cloning etc., I have already answered this question. I warn the mankind that if you disregard the Quranic warning of not interfering, or the consequences of your interference with the creation of God, you may create genetic slaves which will begin to rule you. And there will be no running away from them. If this is what you want, go ahead and do it. But let's hope we'll not live long enough to see that.
Yes. Thank you.
Yes.
It's been written recently in a newspaper editorial that Judaism, Christianity, Islam and Hinduism appear to overlap.
Yes.
Do we subscribe to this idea?
Of course, all religions overlap. They have to, or they have no connection with the source of origin. You see, whenever there is a common source, there is bound to have, the overlapping is bound to happen. So if there is a common source of origin of human species, see, so many things, the majority of our characteristics overlap, right? Please. Yes.
I have one last question. The elections are coming up.
No, time is only for one last question, I think. Yes, please.
The elections are coming up in the UK.
Yes.
What is the point in voting elections where all parties would appear very similar, all fail to change things for the better?
In Urdu, this problem has been answered in a cliche. It says that Andho mein Kana Raja, when all are blind, the one eyed has the right to rule. See?
The least worst, as I said before.
Right, right. Anything else? It is time for another question.
No. My questions,
I was going to ask, I've got one last question about what role does Islam
have? How many last questions have you asked?
Yeah.
No, I welcome that.
You know the PS and the PPS.
This is
the PPS.
That's right.
What role would Islam have in a fragmentary countries such as Albania, which are going through tremendous problems at the moment? We've seen, is it the next Bosnia, Albania?
Albania, already I've spoken before in this session.
Yes.
The previous session, last week.
Right. I missed that.
You know, I was afraid something of that nature would happen. Because, as far as my analysis of the situation is concerned, one may not agree with me. This is not my answer in the capacity of Khalifa Uthul Musi. So you have a right to disagree with me as Europeans.
Yes.
My study of the whole situation of Europe is that the problem of Bosnia was caused largely because of their distrust of Islam and what it may do within Europe. If it has a strong foothold, it will create difficulties, particularly in the light of the growing ambitions in some countries that through Islam we can conquer other territories instead of humans. This territorial conquest through Islam is the deadliest concept which has risen in these days against Islam. So with those fears lurking in their minds, they did not like a Muslim Bosnia. So I have always been wondering, and this is what I have been telling my Tafsir people, etc., that be watchful. You must reach there fast enough, fast and before any disaster happens. Because if you create Ahmadis, Ahmadi Muslims are so peaceful and so balanced that some of their fears at least will be put to rest. So if they still intend to do cruelty, let them, but God will save us then. But I suspected that their different religious groups within
Albania,
Liberia was the word which is coming to my mind. Yes, thank you very much. Within Albania, having run across the world for the monetary gains in the name of religion. Christians have been going to the west and the Muslims to the east and contacting Libya and Iran and Turkey and whatnot. Huh? And this was being watched very closely by your intelligence. And this gave a foothold to some of the Muslim sects or governments with which Europeans or Americans did not feel safe. And that is what I noticed through reports of my missionaries to Albania. They told me that there is so much activity of Christian priests sent from all European countries, overwhelmingly from America. And they run about in every place and they see things and watch everything and create churches and this and that. That is to own them back for Christianity. Not for Christianity, but for the political role that Christianity can play in Europe. So what blunder has been committed by the Muslims by mixing religion with politics has also been repeatedly committed by Europeans and the Western powers, but not so stupidly as it is done by the unfortunate Muslims. They do it, you know, under camouflage, or this guy, so that guy. So this is exactly what is happening in Albania, and still I think we have a role to play. We'll continue to bring moderation to the views of the Albanians. And we will continue to tell them that religion owes its obligation and loyalty to God, and loyalty to the human interest is also a part of that. It stems from it. So without forgetting it, you will not serve any purpose of God or godly ideologies. This is our mission, which we will continue to fulfill, inshallah.
Inshallah.
Right? Thank you. And how are you?
Fine?
Very well, thank you.